So let's deal with the matter at hand. Bannon's quote, "There is no military solution. It's all a bluff to say that we could go in that direction." What is your reckoning?
Well, first, Chris, let me just say that if the North Koreans intended the trajectory of that missile to go over Japan, that is a big Rubicon they've crossed. They have done this before, but with satellites. And the first time they've done it with a military missile. Now, the thing I'm curious about is whether they actually meant to do it. They weren't too far away from a major U.S. Air Force base in Misawa, Japan, which is in northern Honshu, not too far away from Hokkaido. The earlier track I saw, it looked like they maybe were trying to aim it in the water, over the water between those two islands. Second, the options on the table, to quote the president's phrase, are actually no different than they were before. And this may be the first time I've ever agreed with Mr. Bannon, but our options are, in fact, limited. I think, though, there needs to be a distinction between a peremptory military option, which was being kicked around, bandied around at one point, and then as contrasted with a reaction, particularly if the North Koreans do something kinetic. That is, if that missile had broken up over Japan and parts of it fallen on Japan, or particularly on our base, we'd be in a much different place. And I think you get into the options for reaction, and there are potential options. I would guess our implicit red line, and I don't know, but I'm just guessing, is that if there were kinetic damage done by a North Korean missile, I think that would be at least implicitly our red line. Mm-hmm. And of course, the problem, as Mr. Bannon observed, is we don't know what their red line is, whether they would just react in kind or pause or an all-out cataclysmic attack against the South. And that's what makes it such a difficult problem. And I sense that President Trump is beginning to realize this after the campaign rhetoric. It's not unlike what he said about Afghanistan.
Right.
And I think, by the way, we came out in the right place there. So I think the right path now, despite this Rubicon being crossed, is to continue the carrot of negotiations. I think, as advocated by Secretary Tillerson, and the stick of sanctions. And of course, the China is crucial here, and China can't possibly like what happened with this missile shot over Japan.
Right.
And of course, that's underpinned by our military. One other comment I'd make is that I was heartened by the toned-down rhetoric today from the president, where he just said a reminder that all options are on the table. And what this helps to do is to try, where we avoid this vicious circle that we've gotten ourselves in, where the North Koreans do something provocative and we step up the rhetoric, which causes them to be even more paranoid, and they generate another provocative act. And so one way to help tamp that down is to tamp our own rhetoric down. In fact, I was really impressed with Secretary Mattis several missile tests ago when he simply said, "We note the North Koreans have fired a missile and we have no further comment." And I think there's some real merit in that. One last comment, if I may, Chris.
Absolutely. That's why you're on.
That's that just to compare the situation in North Korea with the situation in Iran. And what this illustrates is it is much better and much easier to negotiate away a nuclear weapons capability with a nation that doesn't yet have it than it is with a nation that aspires to and has nuclear weapons. So my thought here is that if we're going to abrogate or decertify the JCPOA, the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or the nuclear deal we had with Iran, I certainly hope we have a plan B. Because once that option is foreclosed, it's gone.